In this video, I'm going to show you how to go from this to this using Illustrator and Photoshop. Knowing how to create a base for your site analysis is a vital skill for any architecture student, and learning this can actually help you in many other representation challenges. So if you stick to the end of the video, I guarantee you, you'll learn some useful tricks. First up, we need to address the line work here. There are many ways to gather this initial data. It all comes down to your location and what you have access to. But beforehand, let me tell you that this can be a very time-consuming step. It depends on the method you use. So here's a list of possible ways to get them, and you can see what's available for you. 1. And this is possibly the best scenario, your city or the city you're designing in has a great urban department. And they provide all of this data in a .dot shapefile that can be opened in a GIS type of software or even CAD files containing all of it. This was the case with my final thesis, which there's a video about it if you haven't seen it, but all of the maps and base maps I had access to this ready-to-use data saved me so much time. Depending on your city's urban department, they might even provide you with an interactive website containing it all, and it's often possible to export CAD or PDF files from it. These are two examples from cities here in Brazil, where I'm based. You may also want to check with your professors where you can get a hold of data like this. They can often show you the way. Or if you don't have access to this, you might want to try out the second method. 2. Using websites like Cadmapper. It's not the most reliable method and doesn't always work, but if you need a quick base that doesn't need much detail, this might be it. Websites like this covers most of the world, but from my experience, only major cities really have proper data. This can also be a quick start to then enhance it with more information in another software. Which then leads me to the third method. 3. Manually drawing it. This is some hard work and will not fit in every project due to the amount of time it takes. But if you don't have official data from an urban department and you need a high level of fidelity, you will need to resort to this method. I couldn't tell you how many times I've done this through architecture school and even when I did an internship at an urbanism firm, so it's somewhat of a common practice, I'd say. And this is the method I've used on this particular drawing. This is the city of Colombo in Sri Lanka. I exported an 8K satellite image from Google Earth, not the web page, but using the software. I made sure to include a graphic scale, and then using ARCHICAD, I made the image up to scale and then started tracing all of the data I needed. I only needed this as line work, so I didn't use any 3D or BIM tools here, and I could have used any CAD software for this for sure, I know, but it's just that I'm used to ARCHICAD interface and its tools, even in 2D. But this doesn't impact the final result at all, use whatever you're most proficient with. Just make sure to separate the elements by color, more specifically, line color. And this is vital as we're going to use these attributes to separate them into layers later in Illustrator. Now, wait a second, I know you're going to say that I could have then just stylized here in ARCHICAD, which would have saved me so much time and I didn't even need any extra programs, and that is completely true. But the workflow I'm using, Illustrator and Photoshop, fits in any type of the previous data gathering methods. Imagine you just had a PDF to begin with. The workflow I'm showing you makes that doable. And also, Illustrator and Photoshop combined give you a lot more creative freedom, not to mention that it's a lot more forgiving. And as architecture students, you'll find that quite helpful when creating site analysis for your university projects. Now, on the other hand, when you're an architect working in firms with other demands, you might need to consider if this is worth it or not. Maybe for that average client that doesn't notice the extra work, you just use the built-in tools inside your CAD or BIM software. But then for a special project where you want to feature it on your website or send it to ArcDaily, then this workflow I'm showing you can open representation and style options. I'm not here to tell you what's right or wrong, I'm just showing you the possibilities, okay? Alright, back to the tutorial. After all of this data stuff, what you need to have is then this PDF with your base map exported. In this specific example here, I used an A0 on a 1 to 2000 scale, and I'm using the metric system, which yields roughly a 4K document in 72 DPIs. This is all subjective, I'm just sharing these numbers as reference, but each project will have its specific needs, so adapt as you go, alright? Now optional, but this opens even more creative possibilities. Also get a matching satellite photo. There's some cool tricks you can do using it. If you manually drew all of it as in method 3, then you should have it ready to go. If your urban department also provides that, make sure to export it to use it. However, if you are in Cadmapper or any other method, this might be harder to align even if you export separately from Google Earth, so keep that in mind. This video doesn't have any sponsors, but if you allow me, I'm actually going to plugin or packs store. This is a way you can support the work that I do here. The packs were carefully crafted by us, and they range from human figures to isometric objects, textures, and much more. They are quality assets that enhance your images and drawings, and having your own library of resources can save you a ton of time. Trust me, I've been there on free Google images, trying to find something that isn't low quality to add to my drawings. It's just not practical. That's why we created the packs in the first place. I'm gonna leave a link in the video description, so go check them out. Thank you for supporting this channel so that I can keep creating free content here on YouTube. And if you're new here and are into architectural representation and visualization, consider subscribing. Now open up Adobe Illustrator and open the PDF as a new file. Do not drag and drop into an existing file. You need to be able to select the elements individually. Then after that, we need to release all of these objects, and most likely they will be clipped and grouped. This varies, but make sure to select all, Control A, and go to Object, Clipping Mask, and Release. Repeat that as many times as needed. Oh, and also depending on the software, you might need to go to Object, Compound Path, and Release as well. Again, repeat as many times as necessary. And lastly, make sure that things are not grouped. Sometimes they are, so go to Object and Ungroup. You can test that by single clicking on a line and see if you're able to individually select it. If you can do that, you're good to go. So after I'm sure I undid all of it, I then delete these invisible frames here. They are not necessary and sometimes they can weigh down the file. So next, we're going to start sorting this out. Pick a category and then select one object and go to Select, Same, and pick what best fits your element here. In my case, it's stroke color, but this could have been done with a black and white document that has multiple line weights the same way. You'll then just use the stroke weight as a filter. Got it? Then create a new layer, and with that selection in place, drag the content to the newly created layer. Make sure to rename this layer to organize your document, and repeat that for as many elements as you need. This is the way I prefer to do this. There are many ways you could approach this type of task. You could use groups, but it's a quick step I take, creating the layers, that later allows me to easily select an entire category and apply uniform change to it, and still being able to move the things around individually. Now, depending on your original file, elements might not come as closed shapes, meaning that you won't be able to apply fill to it, but worry not, there's an easy workaround for this. For example, with the buildings, I'm going to quickly select them all by clicking here. I'm also going to hide all of the other layers by Alt-clicking on the visibility eye, then Control-A to select all and hit K to bring up the Live Paint Bucket tool. You now only need to click once outside of any shape. Once it shows expand up here, it means that you've successfully transformed your selection into a live paint group. Now grab the selection tool and invert the stroke to fill to see the result. You can either click on this little arrow here or Shift X. Pretty cool, right? Now up here, click on expand and go ahead and even ungroup it all. Now we're free to style in any way, and be sure to grab references to look for inspiration. But usually a project's needs will dictate more or less the outcome of your site analysis, so use it to your advantage. As an example, if you hit D with all of your buildings selected, you'll make their appearance go back to default, which is white fill and black 1-point stroke. I often like to leave the buildings as white, but then I add a light gray fill to the blocks or plots. This gives a subtle contrast without drawing too much attention to them. And with this structure in place, you have complete freedom and you could achieve something like this, for example. Make sure to play with line weight and line color. Also, base yourself on other images to capture a well-balanced color scheme. Illustrator by itself could be enough, and honestly, most of the maps I did while still in school were only using Illustrator. But if you'd like to take them one step further and use Photoshop's power, continue watching. By the way, this is a method I use to create diagrams. We have a course that teaches this workflow with a lot more detail. So if you're interested in leveling up your diagrams game, there's a link in the video description. Or even these free short tutorials here on YouTube might be a great place to start. Okay, so let's move on to Photoshop. But first, here in Illustrator, you gotta find the dimensions of your artboard. So click on the artboard tool to see your artboard dimensions. I rounded that A0 that I mentioned to a 4K document, which is a 3840x2160 pixels. Again, specifics really don't matter here, as your file will most certainly have something different. But take note of this number, your number, I mean. Then open Photoshop. Create a new file exactly on that size, and then go to File, Place Linked, and select the Illustrator file we've been working with, the .ai file. Under Crop 2, select Media Box to maintain the artboard boundary, and then hit OK. That's it, you now have both files linked, so when you make any changes to Illustrator, it automatically updates here in Photoshop. Quick note, most of you probably already know this, but if you notice that your Photoshop file is looking pixelated and Illustrator isn't, this is completely normal as Photoshop works with pixels and Illustrator with vector shapes. You don't need infinite quality here, just enough for where you're gonna display it. But if you actually want to increase the size, then do it over Illustrator to then adjust it in Photoshop, okay? Now it's here that you can overlay the satellite image. And then I'm going to Control C on the water shapes in Illustrator. And then Control V here in Photoshop. And make sure to hit the smart object. And if you paste it zoomed out, it will align perfectly. Then use these shapes as masks. Control click on the thumbnail to create the selection. And on the satellite image layer, create a new mask. Amazing, right? Now finish off by playing with the blend mode. I used screen in this example, but that depends on what you have below it, like the water fill that I'm using here. Sometimes that's multiply that's gonna work out. And you could also make this with the buildings, which is kinda cool. But my satellite image here is slightly slanted. Maybe the satellite when it took the photo wasn't properly on top of the city, so that doesn't align too perfectly. Here in Photoshop, you can add color fills with the multiply blend mode, and highlight buildings or blocks. Same way you can add textures or patterns. Again, with the structure in place, it's quite easy to stylize it. And since I have this set up with a scale back in ArchiCAD, I can easily export another file full of circles with set radius. This can be useful when talking about an affected area or how far a certain public equipment can reach. Drop shadow under the blending modes is also quite fun to use. It can create extra contrast in subtle ways. This can be added to buildings and on the radios, for example. Back in Illustrator, we could, for example, add some sort of train tracks attribute to the train line. We just gotta play with the dash options a little bit. I know I cannot show you every single style here, but they are simple moves, and the idea is actually to show you that the options are limitless. Let me know in the comments if this video was helpful and if you have any questions. You know I'm pretty active there. And also DM me on Instagram any reference images you might have as suggestions for future videos. Thanks a lot for watching. Don't forget to subscribe.